So good morning, everybody. I'm the editor of Screen International, as Sten introduced me as. And we're very lucky to have Vice President Andrus Ansip here this morning to talk about the proposed reforms of the both copyright and also the initiative for the digital single market, which is obviously a big topic of discussion these days. So I wanted to just, first of all, thank you for being here. Mr. Ansip, and I wanted to start by...
Thank you very much for inviting me. It's my pleasure to be back home once again.
Yes, in your home country. So just as a way to kick off, I wonder if you could start by talking about... The digital single market is obviously a kind of far bigger package than the EU copyright reform laws, but that is kind of the most pressing thing that is happening in terms of there's going to be a draft proposal for the copyright reform coming out quite soon. Could you tell us in a few words how you see the digital single market and the role of copyright evolving to meet new technological realities?
This is quite a long story. In the European Union, we were able to create a single market in physical meaning, but digital single market does still not exist in the European Union. And cost of non-European digital meaning is huge. According to analysis prepared by the European Parliament, this cost is 415 billion euros per year. And this amount of money will increase with the years when we will be not able to create digital single market. And this question is not only in money, this is also about our fundamental rights. Why we have to accept discrimination on basis of your nationality or where your credit card is issued on the 21st century in the European Union? We don't. We have to create digital single market in the European Union, and everybody will benefit from that. So when we're talking about digital single market and digital single market strategy, then we are talking about three pillars. At first, we have to support free movements of goods and services in the European Union. Free movement of goods and services, capital, free movement of people. This is reality in physical meaning in the European Union, but in digital meaning, sorry, it does not exist. So, fragmentation of the markets. Now, we have 28 different regulations dealing, for example, with the consumer protection issues. And especially for small and medium-sized companies, it's practically impossible to understand how those 28 different regulations, so they are somewhere protecting consumers and then what kind of obligations those businesses they are getting from those different regulations. We will try to harmonize those contract rules and this will be our first proposal in this December already according to our digital single market strategy. Second proposal will be about portability of the content. We have approximately 20% of people in the European Union, it means 100 million people, who would like to get access to digital content in some other countries, but because of copyright restrictions, they cannot. Approximately 271 million trips with at least one overnight stay in another EU member states are made by Europeans during the year, and many of those people would like to get access to their legally bought e-books, audiobooks, music, movies in their own countries, but because of copyright restrictions, they cannot. So, portability of the content will be the second proposal this year. But we have 16 aims, and we promised to make all the other proposals during the next year. But digital single market and free movement of goods and services. At first, fragmentation, then copyright issues, then parcel delivery prices. some people, they are surprised. You are dealing with digital issues. Why you have to deal with parcel delivery prices? But looking on those prices, we can say that those prices are quite strange prices. In some countries, difference between domestic parcel delivery prices and then cross-border parcel delivery prices is 2 times, 3 to 5 times. It's normal. But in the country I know best, here in Estonia, difference is 9.5 times. But there is one EU member state where difference between domestic parcel delivery prices, I'm talking about 2 kilograms parcels, and cross-border parcel delivery prices in the European Union is 22 times. 22 times. Who can send some books, for example, paying? That's a high prices. And it's those parcel delivery prices, high prices, they are obstacles in our way towards flourishing e-commerce. So geo-blocking in meaning of rerouting, I think majority of people in the European Union, they experienced geo-blocking in meaning of rerouting. What does it mean? You would like to buy something, a bottle of water, for example, from the first shop you visited, but they say that, no, you are from wrong country, you have to visit that shop, and then maybe in this another shop they will deny from services or will ask for much higher prices. So this is about first pillar of digital single market strategy. But we have to deal also with our infrastructure, networks, and we have to deal with digital economy issues, with e-garment issues. It means questions about standards, interoperability, spectrum issues, etc. So copyright reform is an important part of digital single market strategy, but this is just one part, not the whole package.
So it's quite a big thing to harmonize, you know, 28 different sets of rules at the moment for across the entire EU for copyright. I mean, I know we won't see the proposals until December, but do you think you have a strong, you know, what the package is going to be appealing to all the 28 countries who are going to be asked to kind of reform their own copyright rules to kind of bring it into an EU-wide package?
Talking about copyright reform, I would like to say that we don't want to destroy the whole system based on principle of territoriality. We don't want to make some kind of explosion, revolution. We would like to have this step-by-step approach. And when we are talking in the European Commission about copyright reform, then we are mainly talking about three issues. At first, we have to support access to the content. Then we have to deal with exceptions. Now, when I'm talking about exceptions, so then I'm thinking about our handicapped people, about blind people, but also about educational issues, about our libraries. Today, once again, where we have 28 different types of different exceptions, and for handicapped people, for example, is practically impossible to understand what kind of exceptions there are in some other countries mentioned for to help them. So, there is a third issue. It's also about exceptions, we can say. It's text and data mining. Now, in the European Union, in some EU member states, scientists, they can use text and data mining, but in some other countries, it's practically prohibited, and according to my understanding, we have to allow to use those innovative tools everywhere. I'm talking about text and data mining in the European Union for our scientists. We all believe that very soon, but already today, it will be possible to get all kind of really useful different correlations from big data and text and data mining. It's possible, or it will be possible, to find similar patterns from big data or using text and data mining. About what I'm talking about. I myself, for example, I hope one lovely day somebody will call me from hospital and will say, Mr. Ansip, please go immediately to the hospital because most likely you will get stroke after 6 hours. So I will be not extremely happy about this phone call, but I will be grateful anyway because to avoid stroke, it's something else than to deal with the consequences. And I know my health foundation will be even extremely happy because it will be much cheaper to avoid those bad consequences. So, but from big data, very soon we will get all kind of really useful correlations for our people, useful similar patterns which will help our people. And that's why we have to allow text and data mining everywhere in the European Union. In smaller countries, for example, in some cases, it is practically impossible to collect data in meaning of big data. If there is one or two cases per year, then what kind of correlations or similar patterns you can find? It's practically impossible. But today, Europe is quite successful in meaning of scientific articles based on text and data mining. Let's say US is lagging behind of us, but it's mainly because of the United Kingdom, because of your country, because scientists, they can use text and data mining in the United Kingdom, but in some other countries, it's prohibited. In the United Kingdom, yes. In the United States, yes, they can use text and data mining. In Japan, yes, once again, they can. In the European Union, so.
So on the other side, though, there is a strong argument that mandatory EU-wide copyright titles and pan-European licenses would mean a limitation on the freedom of contracts for rights holders, and therefore a devaluation of rights in general. And I guess this is where the film industry is particularly interested in what the proposals are about. Can you address what you think the reforms will mean on that respect?
I'm not promoting pan-European licenses. I think Estonians, they all know, and our guests, they know also that we are producing films also here in Estonia, and some of those movies, that they are quite popular movies. For example, Tangerine got even Oscar nomination this year. So, but at the same time, we know that it will be pretty difficult to sell pan-European licenses to show movies produced in Estonia. Maybe there will be interest to watch those movies in commercial meaning in our neighboring countries, in Finland, Latvia, Lithuania, maybe also in Poland, but in some other countries, in Italy, for example, I don't think. And that it will be really expensive to pay for pan-European licenses when there is a very, very low demand majority of EU member states. No sense. As I said, we don't want to destroy the whole system based on principle of territoriality. I'm not against principle of territoriality, but I'm against absolute territorial exclusivity. Today, some people say that don't touch our copyright legislation, it works. But according to public opinion polls, 20% of internet users say that they are using VPN to get access to movies, music, e-books, audiobooks. 20%. It's a huge amount of money our creators are not getting. People are ready to pay to get access through VPN. I'm sure they are ready to pay to creators also. And it's not an issue only here in the European Union. In Latin American countries, even 35% of internet users are using VPN to get access to digital content. According to one TechCrunch article, even one third of Canadians are using VPN and US IP addresses to watch movies via Netflix. Why? According to that article, choice is rich in the United States and not so rich in Canada. So, 68% of film viewers in the European Union said they are using so-called free downloads. 68%. And half of those people, they said, we are doing that every week. Once again, it's a huge amount of money. We have to allow legal access to movies, music, e-books, audiobooks to our people. There is a really strong correlation between legal access and illegal access. Illegal downloads. For example, from Australia and connected with Spotify, when volume of legal downloads of Spotify increased in Australia, then at the same time, volume of illegal downloads of torrent decreased. So I believe in our people. People would like to behave as honest people. They don't want to steal. But in some cases, legal access is impossible. And somehow we have to say that we are pushing our people to steal. But is it stealing when they paid for VPN already and legal access wasn't possible? Is VPN illegal or not? This is also an issue. People, they paid.
So this is an issue you want to address with portability, the idea that you can obviously take your, if you buy it in one country, you can use it anywhere else in the European Union. I think, are you also proposing the idea that if there's a sort of platform service in one country that a European Union citizen can access that, they can just, you know, they can approach that that service from outside that home country and ask to sort of watch a movie or download a song or whatever?
Yes, we will deal also with platform, but our first proposal will be about portability. If you got access to digital content, legal access to digital content in one country, you have to get right to have this access to this content also in another country. I'm not talking about free access. This dividing line is a subscription. It doesn't matter, free of charge, paid subscription, but if on basis of subscription, we can provide also portability of the content, and this portability of the content will cover not only copyrighted materials, but also sports.
So do you, this...
And sorry, but there will be second part of this copyright reform. This proposal we would like to make next year, and it will be about cross-border access and about piracy, because piracy is a really big problem for us, and not only here in the European Union, but everywhere around the world. Our creators, they are losing huge amounts of money. Today we have lose-lose situation. I would like to enjoy masterpieces created by creators, but you are not accepting my money. We would like to create win-win situation. I would like to enjoy, I will pay, creators will get more money, and we will get more movies.
It sounds great, very utopian, and it's very geared towards obviously consumers being able to access this material. I wonder if the consideration for the actual people who own the rights or the, you know, the people who are creating it, whether, how that sort of factors into it. This is very, it seems a very kind of consumer-oriented kind of initiative. But I know you've talked about as well about the sort of, you know, the amount of money that the economy is losing out on by not having a digital single market. But I wonder if you could just talk a little bit about, you know, what protections will be available for people who are creating the content, what the future is in that respect, in terms of what...
As we all know, piracy is a huge problem. And those amounts of money we are losing because of piracy, they're really remarkable amounts of money. Let's say in all those bigger EU member states, those losses are 500 to 700 million euros per year. I'm talking about Germany, about the United Kingdom. Those are really remarkable amounts of money. And who are those losers? Creators. They are not creating their money. We cannot talk in this meaning about fair remuneration because somebody is getting access to those movies just free of charge. So we would like to pay much more attention on following the money principle. Today, according to some analyses, 227 million US dollars per year are paid by legal companies to those who allow illegal downloads of movies. 227 million US dollars. Once again, huge amount of money. And those among those companies, there are also our European legal companies. Of course, when you are talking with those people, then they say, no, we didn't do that. Those are robots delivering our advertising money. So we didn't do that. But 227 million. Of course, some of those who are paying, I mean, legal companies to those companies which allow illegal downloads, they know that they are supporting piracy, but those contacts are cheaper and they are more, this is more efficient usage of advertising money. So, and even some film producers, they are donating piracy in this way because if they are not able to avoid stealing, then they would like to get at least something from that. They would like to get those cheap contacts. But we have to deal with those issues. And it's possible. In Norway, for example, just 5 years ago, even now I'm talking about music, even 80% of people said that they are using free downloads. 80%. And now they say 4%. How it happened? At first, they provided legal access to digital content to their people. And secondly, of course, they tackled the piracy. And I believe it's possible to create a win-win situation. Doing nothing, it means that we will not protect our creators, we will not protect our cultural diversity, and I don't think decision makers, they have to accept today's situation where 68% of film viewers say that they're using free downloads.
Well, were you, given all that, were you surprised that the film industry reacted so strongly when the digital single market proposals were first announced earlier this year? Because there was quite a uproar about what the proposals would seem to implicate for, you know, obviously the lack of the removal of territoriality, the whole kind of principles that the European independent film industry is based upon.
I think there was a lot of misunderstandings in the very beginning. Even you asked about pan-European licenses, but once again, I never promoted only usage of pan-European licenses. Principle of territoriality will stay. When we're talking about portability of the content, then we are talking about temporary usage of this principle. When people, they are traveling somewhere temporarily, we don't want to limit how long it will last. It's up to entrepreneurial freedom, up to partners who will agree in that, but it will be temporary measure. We will not create an environment where somebody can just misuse those regulations which will allow portability of the content. So there were some people who got an understanding according with the commissioner wants to allow free access to everybody. But I'm not representing Pirate Party here. I'm talking about paid access. I'm talking about win-win situation. We would like to provide more money to our creators. We don't want to destroy the whole business model. But we have to make some changes in this business model. And as we know, it's quite complicated to change existing business model. When we're talking about some other areas, the same story. Phone calls, it's quite difficult to accept that there will be one single market, but now decision was made. We will abolish those roaming surcharges since 15th of June 2017. But we cut roaming surcharges in the European Union three times already. Those are 80% on an 80% lower level right now than they were just 6 years ago. So, and every time when we decided to cut to those roaming surcharges administratively, then service providers they started to complain. They said that now we have to increase domestic prices, and only rich people traveling somewhere in Europe they will benefit from that. But in the end of the day, the service providers said that yes, we lost in margins, but we gained in volumes, and it was even profitable for us. So. Despite criticism, I would like to say that we have to find a solution which will be really beneficial for all the parties, for our filmmakers, for film viewers. We have to understand that copyright is mentioned to protect both sides, filmmakers, creators, and also our society. There has to be balance. But today, I think existing copyright system is not properly protecting our creators, and neither our society. There is a problem.
I think one of the arguments is that you know, these reforms will actually help cultural diversity because you'll allow greater access to people who want to view, you know, films from other countries. And yet the argument from the other side is that the cultural diversity will be harmed because, you know, the current financing model for European film exists on a very kind of being able to sell rights territory by territory. So I just wonder if you can talk a little bit about that obviously clear divide between what the industry says and what the European Commission is saying in terms of how cultural diversity will be protected in a new digital single market.
Cultural diversity in the European Union is really great value. But today we can see that those global players, they are able to deal with 28 different markets also. But our smaller producers, they are in difficulties. So this fragmentation is somehow, I don't want to say beneficial for bigger players, but definitely this fragmentation is creating barriers for smaller producers. In Europe, you are producing really good movies. But sorry to say, even in bigger EU member states, let's say 17 out of 20 in top 20 TV series are series produced in the United States of America. I met with former director of the German Film Archive. He said that they have hundreds, even thousands of really good movies in their archive. Also, they are already digital movies. But nobody is ready to pay for territorial licenses to show those movies somewhere because demand is low. And practically there is no solution. How we can get access to those movies? Or let's take another situation. Maybe in Sweden they produced a new movie and there is a low demand, let's say in Italy. But demand is really low. There are 400,000 Swedish people living around the European Union, not in Sweden. So, but I'm not talking only about Swedish people who would like to watch this new Swedish movie, so-called new Swedish movie. People, they would like to get access to this movie. They are ready to pay for that. But today, nobody is providing this service. I'm talking about cultural diversity. Cultural diversity is great value, even if this cultural diversity is locked in some kind of archives or inside of some concrete countries. But it will be much bigger value when our people, they will get access to this movie. And sometimes there are some kind of problems even when demand is not low. Let's take Chariots of Fire and London Olympic Games. I remember those games and opening ceremony. I think people all remember about this opening ceremony. His Majesty jumping from the airplane and then Mr. Bean running together with those Olympic heroes there. And then on all those awarding ceremonies, wonderful music written by Vangelis promoting this movie, Chariots of Fire. I think there were millions of people, not only in the European Union, who wanted to watch this movie. So did I. Who provided this service? On Google, I couldn't find any legal service providers. Only those who provided illegal access to this movie. So creators, once again, they lost money. I had a really good meeting with Lord Putnam, and he told also that there was a huge demand because of this promotion. This movie got with London Olympic Games, but reaction was not really quick.
Yeah, I think you met last week with some European filmmakers, including Michel Hazan, Vicious, Annette K. Olsson, and Eric Lartigo. What conversations did you have with them? What came out of those discussions that perhaps put some ideas in your head that you hadn't thought about? I mean, did anything like that happen? It's, you know, now that you're talking to filmmakers directly about what their response is to the proposals, what sort of things did they say to you?
We have the same understanding in those most important issues. At first, let's take importance of cinema. Now we know that role of traditional media is decreasing. People, they are not following some long texts. They are looking on headlines and people, they are somehow in boxes. They are not following even the same headlines anymore. Facebook, Twitter, small boxes. But there has to be somebody who will be able to unite society. And I strongly believe cinema is one of those who is able to take this role. So cinema, movies, this is important for me. And this is, of course, important for filmmakers. Then piracy. According to my understanding, this is a huge problem. And according to filmmakers, this is a real problem. We have to fix this problem. And we can say there is a common ground for further reforms. Then principle of territoriality. As I said many, many times already, we would like to keep this principle of territoriality, but at the same time, we have to provide also legal access to movies to our people. So I think there was a lot of common in our discussions. Of course, our aim in the European Commission is to work together with all the stakeholders. Now, actors are unhappy. Directors of movies, they are unhappy because somebody is stealing their money. They are not well paid. Talking about platforms, people are complaining that there is value cap. This notice and takedown principle does not work. It's talking about platforms. It works, this principle of notice and takedown, when we are talking about illegal content. If somebody uploaded illegal content to some platforms, then it's quite easy to notice and take down this content. But when there is legal content used illegally, then it's much more complicated situation. Because how those who say that they are neutral intermediaries, they have to know, is this legal content there legally or illegally? So musicians, filmmakers, they are asking, please take down. It takes time. And finally, they will take down this content. But after 2 minutes, somebody else will put once again this content on those platforms. And once again, please take down. Now, musicians, filmmakers, they ask, please take down and keep it down. So we have to make those rules more clear. What is allowed, what is not allowed. So in this meaning, there is common ground between politicians and filmmakers.
Did you talk about movies with the directors? I think, are you a movie lover yourself? Are you, I mean, you mentioned Chariots of Fire.
I liked this
like
movie.
You like that movie?
Yeah. But this is, of course, not the only movie I like. Yeah.
You like Tangerine, the Estonian film?
Well, of course. I really enjoyed this movie. But,
yeah. But how do you like to view movies? I mean, do you go to the cinema? Or are you a Netflix or Amazon subscriber? I mean, what's your...
Let's say mainly cinema.
Cinema.
Last movie. And the airplane, of course.
The airplane.
Sorry to say, but the small screens and but the people they're watching movies using their smartphones even. So according to some statistics, people they are using smartphones even when they are crossing to watch some kind of content when they are driving the car and crossing the streets. 10% driving the car, I knew. But now I experienced also in Brussels how it is to cross the street, not paying attention what is happening there, just to watch movie. So it works. But yeah, James Bond, of course, was last movie I saw it in cinema for me. But
So I mean, we mentioned Netflix and Amazon. I mean, one of the obviously the you know, concerns by the proposal that we have some water.
Oh no, thanks.
The fact that this could, you know, open the door to these major giants to just sort of, you know, dominate
the
market.
But I can't agree that we will somehow open the door to giants, to big players. Those big players, they are successful in Europe anyway. Let's think about, for example, those 17 out of 20. They can deal with that with 28 relatively small markets. We in Europe, we have difficulties.
Well, I don't think Netflix has been very successful in France so far. Probably for specifically the rules they have in place to maybe prevent.
From
maybe
France,
we can
learn many lessons, and foundability is one of those issues connected also with movies. In many countries in the European Union, and it's quite difficult to find legal how you can get legal access to movies. But in France, there is a CNC. And this is an excellent solution, according to my understanding. But living in Belgium, yeah, it's easy to find using CNC those movies you would like to watch, and of course you're ready to pay. But then they say, "No, sorry, only for us, French people in Belgium." Dream on. Don't even think about watching this movie. This is mentioned for our people, not people like you. In Estonia, the same story. So, I didn't want to steal. I wanted to pay. And there is somebody who didn't get my money. Once again, we would like to create a win-win situation.
So, you know, I think... Do you have a particular thoughts on the current the financing model of the, you know, the European independent film landscape in terms of the way it currently exists? Because it does, you know, it's a very specific sort of way that films get made in Europe. That's very different, perhaps.
As I said already many, many times, we don't want to destroy this principle of territoriality or financing model, which is based on principle of territoriality.
Sure. But I think, you know, these moves in this direction certainly kind of imply that there's a, maybe, I don't know, desire or a sort of need for European companies to scale up. I think that's obviously a word that gets mentioned a lot, the sort of, you know, that there's too many small players and there needs to be bigger players to kind of...
But I'm not the right person to say how many players, distributors we have to have in the European Union. It's up to entrepreneurial freedom. It's up to market to say that, and it's not up to the European Commission. And I'm not talking just about creative industry. I'm talking about all the areas, telecom service providers, etc. But more generally speaking, not only about copyright issues, digital single market in the European Union is also needed for our smart young people, startups. We have to ask from ourselves why today our startups, they have to move out from the European Union to the United States to scale up. Why, for example, Spotify had to move out from the Union to the United States to scale up, why it's so complicated to scale up here in the European Union. Potentially is huge. We have 500 million healthy customers here in the European Union. But because of fragmentation of this market, it's so complicated to scale up within 6 months, for example, here in the European Union. And startups, they are moving out. And what does it mean for us? We are losing our smart brains. We are losing those well-paid jobs. Yeah, Spotify is back here in Europe, taking country by country. But their headquarters is not here anymore. And it happens with many. Many of those startups. I'm happy that in the field of fintechs, financial technologies, there are really successful companies based on European investments. So today, some people they are complaining about some kind of search engines which are, according to their understanding, too powerful. But what will happen when some giants will take over all those bank transactions, for example, in the European Union? It will be a totally different situation, and we have to support innovations, and we have to create also a digital single market in the European Union to support our digital industry to increase competitiveness in the European Union. So digital single market, it's a broader issue, but copyright is a really important part of digital single markets. Talking about digital single markets, I'm not ready to create some kind of ranking list from all those aims. We set 16 aims of that how to reach this digital single market in the European Union, and according to my understanding, we cannot say that some of those aims that they are less important for us. If we will not able to reach those aims, nothing will happen. We will create single market anyway. No, but to create digital single market in the European Union, it will be an uphill struggle, no easy victories, because, as I said, there are different interests, lot of vested interests, and some of those interests, they are not so much vested anymore. And it's always complicated to make some changes in existing business models. But talking once again about copyright. So 68% of film viewers are using free downloads. When we will be ready really to say that something is wrong, we have to change existing system. 78, 88, 98%. When? So I think it's time, and sorry to say, we are late already.
Well, thank you very much. At this point, I want to open it up to questions from the audience, because I'm sure people will want to ask a few things to Mr. Ansip before we wrap up. Hard to see, but does anyone have any questions? Yeah, I see straight away a hand right there. I think we have a mic, so just wait till the mic comes up.
Hello, I am Andrus Ansip, representing here Tallinn University, not the public service broadcasting, but I have a question regarding citizenship. So far, licenses for television broadcast are bought by broadcasting companies for territory. This is a case, and I can understand very easily when I am a taxpayer and I travel abroad, I would like to watch a program. But now if the program is available on subscription based, how can Finns who are living here in Estonia subscribe to public service broadcasting and travel abroad and not to watch the broadcasting? Because they haven't paid for that.
Sorry, I couldn't catch the question. If Estonians will travel to some
abroad,
other countries and they subscribe to the content here in Estonia, then they
public can service broadcasting. Public service broadcasting is financed from taxpayers,
yes,
from member state.
Yeah.
And but now it's available through the year. If Finns come to Estonia, they can watch Estonian television.
Mm-hmm.
I mean public service broadcasting, without any restrictions.
Yes, it will stay so in also in future. If they can watch those movies using public broadcast today, then they can continue to do it also in future. In some countries, there is identification also when we're systems when we are talking about public broadcasting. For example, Yle in Finland, just in the neighborhood, is even providing this identification service to their citizens. And I would like to say that in many of EU member states where there are really strong public broadcasters, those. And people, they are getting access to music, films, free of charge, because as taxpayers, they paid for this access already. Why are those identification systems, why are, let's say, so-called subscription, they in future will get access to the same content also when they are traveling somewhere else in other EU member states. Today, let's take Estonia. When I paid for Channel 2, for example, it's not a huge amount of money, 10 euros per year, I think, or something like this. When in abroad or in other EU member states, you can get access to content produced here in Estonia, which is not blocked for other EU member states, but you cannot get without using VPN, which is not
still
so legal in some other countries.
Still.
In future, those people, they will get access without using VPN or another service providers access to this content when they are in some other EU member states.
Still, maybe it's due to my poor English, but the question was that in Finland, Yle's radio, for example, uses geo-blocking. You can watch Yle Arena programs if you are in Finland. But if you travel abroad, you are not able to watch it. And my question was, if Yle or Estonian Public Service Broadcasting will use subscription-based system, that means that these all the people who are citizens can subscribe to the system. Others are not able.
Yes.
But Finns who are living here and traveling abroad, how can they subscribe if they are not citizens for Estonian city, Estonian state? Or Estonians, there are hundreds of thousands of Estonians living abroad.
Yeah. This is, we are talking about two types of cross-border access to the digital content. One is portability. If you are already subscribed, you have access to digital content in one country, then allowing portability, you can have access to this content also in some other EU member states. Second part of this copyright reform will deal with cross-border access. So how people living in Estonia will get, for example, access to movies or music in Finland, and we will deal with those issues. And once again, we have to allow both portability of the content and cross-border access to the content. We have to provide legal access to digital content to our people.
Thank you very much. Question right there.
Yes, hello. My name is Elisabeth Sjåstad. I'm a film director from Norway. I find it very reassuring that you're saying you don't want to upset the question of the territoriality when it comes to financing. But I have to point out that there seems to be a contradiction then if you say that people should then be able to access the content cross-border. In your example of the French film that you wanted to see, what if this film was financed by also getting a pre-buy from a Belgian distributor? And this distributor had not yet decided to put it on the market in Belgium, and you wanted to access it from France. Wouldn't you then upset the system by undermining the rights that are now with the Belgian distributor who has paid money in advance to finance the film? So could you please comment on this, what seems to be a contradiction between allowing the territoriality when it comes to financing, but then distorting it again when it comes to the access? Thank you.
So I'm trying to find this chariots of fire once again. But there are old movies. So those who pay to get territorial licenses, they don't maybe remember about the licenses anymore. But there is demand somewhere else. And what we will say to our people, stay at home. This movie is not mentioned for you. So principle of territoriality will stay. And we don't have plans to change this release window system. I know that some people from industry, they wanted to ask for 6 months, they would like to keep movies in cinemas. According to my understanding, it's up to entrepreneurial freedom. It's up to filmmakers to say for how long period of time they would like to keep those movies in cinemas. 6 months, 16 months, 60 months. It's not up to the European Commission to say, according to my understanding, but I know that not during this mandate, but before us, there were also some ideas to regulate the release window systems in the European Commission, but we don't have that kind of ideas. So if 6 months, up to you. 6 days, up to you. Anyway, now piracy is dictating this periods for how long period those movies they can stay in cinemas. Then video on CDs or DVDs. Once again, it's up to entrepreneurial freedom. For how long period of time filmmakers they would like to keep those movies on DVDs. But when it comes to video on demand, then I would like to ask for cross-border access and portability of the content. So with those changes we are planning to make in the existing copyright legislation, we would like to provide more money to filmmakers. And if filmmakers, they will have more money, they can produce also more movies. You're producing good movies already, but you can do more, having more money.
I think we have time for one more question. One right there.
My name is Birgitte Stermus, and I'm a Danish film director. And I like very much what you say, that I'm going to get richer in the future. I think it's nice because, you know, for the past 5 years, we've been getting poorer and poorer filmmakers. And the reason we've been getting poorer and poorer is because the money stream has changed. And I currently have a feature on Netflix in the US. Nobody tells me how many people see the film. So in terms of showing success with the film, it's impossible because Netflix doesn't release those numbers. I have not received, as a filmmaker, a penny from this sale. I have no access to my audience. And the only thing I can do is when I was in the US, I could check and I could see that 26,000 people had commented on the film. But other than that, I'm left blank. So I'm really curious how it is I'm going to get richer, because I am truly excited about that possibility. If you could tell me a little bit about that.
But you said exactly what I tried to say during the last hour. So you said you're not extremely happy because of the existing system. We have to improve this situation, and this is exactly aim of the European Commission. This is exactly my aim, but we can do it only together. It's not so that that politicians in the European Commission, in the European Parliament, they know what we have to do. We have to do it together. We have to cooperate, and I'm absolutely sure it's possible to create a system, an environment where we are not pushing our people for stealing, and where creators will be fairly remunerated.
But further to that question, does that mean that you would push for more transparency from the OT platforms and the different services that, for instance, she's talking about not having any idea how much her film is being seen on Netflix or how many people are viewing it? Can you push for that transparency?
It's too early to say what kind of measures we will exactly use, but this is one of those options, because a level playing field, fair remuneration is, those are our main aims according to digital single market strategy. So we have to change the system, because now our cultural diversity is not well protected. Diversity of languages is not well protected. Our creators are complaining. They are not fairly remunerated. Partners are not always equal. Somebody has enough power to say, take it or leave it. So there is value gap existing. So we have to deal with all those issues to create level playing field and fair remuneration is definitely one of our aims.
I think we do have time for a few. Yeah, go ahead.
There's no money that goes back into the financing of the films. That's really the issue. Mm-hmm. That's why we're getting poor.
Yeah. There are very different platforms providing those services. Let's take music, for example. Some platforms based on subscriptions, they are paying to musicians 1.6 billion euros. Some other platforms, which are much bigger than those first ones, they are paying just 0.6. And those are not based on subscription, but supported by advertising. They have 1 billion contacts per month even. Those first ones based on subscription, they have 142 million subscribers, and they are paying more. 142 million, 1.6 billion euros, 1 billion contacts, 0.6. Because those big providers, they are powerful enough at first to say, take it or leave it. 0.6 billion, it's also quite remarkable amount of money. Better to take it. So it's not so clear where this role of neutral intermediaries is really neutral, and where from where they are providing actually some services with their advertising, mentioned especially for you, when they are creating some kind of ranking list, mentioned to sell this product for you, when they are adding some value on this product, do they have to pay, or can they still say that we are just neutral intermediaries, we don't know what is happening there. So, and people, of course, they will get access to your movies. But in those cases, you will be not well paid. We have to change this system.
Unfortunately, that is all the time we have. So I just want to thank Vice President Ansip very much for his time today and for a very illuminating discussion on the future of the digital single market in the EU. Thank you very much. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.